Hey everybody, this is Rydo, and we're back to another recording of Hearthstone. Almost said live stream. Today is Friday, February 8th. There must have been some slight delay in games coming out this week because we got a ton of news. And we're also in the middle of the Lunar New Year celebration for Hearthstone, so we're getting really easy, really good daily quests. Nothing here implies to me if I was to re-roll that I would get anything above 100 gold and 100 dust. So it would be kind of silly to do that. The 60 gold and 60 dust, however, if I had one of those, I would reroll. As far as Tavern Brawl, we're done. Which then I think just puts us trying to win ranked victories. And so let's go to Zoo Warlock and just play. That was our number one winning game. And it is also the last game, I think. No, there's still quite a few that do not have 500 wins. In fact, only one of them does. The Paladin has 500 wins. But this one's not at level 60. And that's why I was playing Warlock too. Everything else is at level 60, which means I've put in enough time that I've started to max out everything. In fact, I looked at it, and it apparently, according to the card backs, there's only like 3 months in which I played Hearthstone. I didn't play Hearthstone when it first came out. So I must have really been in pretty early, but not that early. I don't think I was in during the beta, and so maybe the beta just didn't give card backs, or maybe there was an entire year when they didn't give card backs. That could also be a case. And certainly I haven't spent a lot of money. I've spent a tiny, tiny amount, maybe $5, $10 on my main account. And that certainly has put us still at a disadvantage compared to a lot of other people. And this viral card back is not going to be avoidable, really. You're just going to run into it.
Why do you call?
Apparently on mobile, a card back that you got a long time ago from watching something on Twitch and spending actual money to cheer the esports Hearthstone players during that Twitch gave you like a cheer card back. Apparently that was crashing mobile players game, and you had to go on the PC, change the card back to something else, and then you can play on mobile again, which is pretty ridiculous that a card back would crash anything. But also it's kind of ridiculous that there's a card back out there. I thought for a second that it was a secondary card back they were giving that you had to type like an emoji in the chat, but no, that was not the case. You can't even really type an emoji in the chat. You can do it the old school way and make symbols and try to make a smiley face or something, but like with a colon, parentheses, closing parentheses, you can make a smiley face, but that's all you can really do. Let's see, what do we want to do? Just keep on fighting. It doesn't matter if this guy's silenced or not. So yeah, we have a ton of news, and so we need to go through all of that. I may very well have to play some Hearthstone off screen this weekend in just concern that we might get a daily quest that gives 100 gold and 100 dust, and if I don't get it now, I may not ever be able to get it. Alright, what do I want to do? This would be 5, this would be 7. That works fine. I finished playing 60 seconds. It was a very awkward finish to the series, and that series is not gonna go long at all. The thing that was the major problem in there is I could have gone on basically forever playing 60 seconds, but I wasn't enjoying any of it, and I'd seen what felt was more than a reasonable amount of the content. Oh man, I could have won if I had just not played that. Oops. I should have looked at that a little bit closer. Left my options open. I finished 60 seconds, and now I'm trying to play the Manhole Masterpiece Edition, the first game made by Cyan, which is such an old game. It's like, it needs to be run in Windows XP Service Pack 2, according to the discussions on the forum, and you have to install, like, an old version of QuickTime. Yep. That's almost as if I was just rubbing it in at that time. And now he's at rank 60. But I got it running, and so I'm gonna try and play that. Again, I'm really just embracing playing whatever I want to play whenever I want to play it. Not really looking at the scheduling or of anything. I probably need to spend an extra day to schedule things and make sure I'm on target for making sure not things will air, as I'm only scheduling things as I'm only scheduling 2 time slots, I'm just getting further and further ahead in the future, which is exactly what I want to do. In fact, I'd like to finish whatever my Halloween month is going to be before I even start to think about maybe scheduling things to make a third time slot before that point.
Why do you call?
I'm looking at my Twitter feed right now, and a tweet just happened right now. IGN, a company I don't follow, tweeted out the words video games, and Twitter Gaming commented in reply to that with the words love 'em, L-O-V-E apostrophe E-M. Talk about stupid tweets. I mean, seriously. It's one thing for IGN to be stupid and just be like, video games. We need to tweet something out about video games because we haven't tweeted in long enough times. It's another thing for Twitter gaming to jump on top of that, or for them to have a coordinated intention to send out these tweets. I mean, there's a lot of things you could be talking about in video games. You don't have to make ridiculous generic statements. In fact, there's so much to talk about, let's get to it. Not a lot of information out right now, but apparently the Lego Movie 2 video game has been kind of previewed, and they're adding something a little bit different to that. Because I'm looking at this article from Xbox Achievements, the Lego Movie 2 video game is a Lego game with a different preview. Let's hit all this. That It's kind of a mistake. I may have to kill this guy. Let's see what this says. When it comes to the LEGO games, they've had a pretty formulaic template for the last few years, pretty much forever. But TD Games has attempted something different with this one. No, really, they have. Gone are the party systems, which you could have multiple LEGO characters follow you about and help you on whatever foe or puzzle you might come across. Now, there have been LEGO games in the past where the party system was replaced with items instead.
As you command.
Going to silence this. Excuse me. The LEGO Movie 2 video game, players can go through the whole game as just one character. Well, that was also true in the LEGO Lord of the Rings games and LEGO Hobbit games. One character of their choice from a list of hundreds, and even though their own, or even their just their own custom character, because abilities now work across the board. Don't worry though, drop-in, drop-out co-op is still in, so you can enjoy the LEGO adventures with your pals. It would better be. That would be pretty bad. In previous games, you'd need specific characters to perform certain tasks to solve puzzles, but in this game, once you unlock a new building schematic or gadget, you can use it with whichever character you like. When it comes to building something, you need to make sure you've collected the right colored bricks from smashing items around the map, and then you're set. So it's a currency system. It's something that's pretty similar to the popular LEGO Worlds game. Alright. I'm almost gonna have to keep a look here on the time, because I wanna kinda just stay on the America's account and work up ranked for a little bit, even after we do the daily quest. The schematics you're unlocking aren't just for building things like sprinklers or a springboard to progress through the levels, but also include vehicles, entire buildings, and quest-related items too. There's a sandbox mode called Syspocalpster, Syspocalpster. Which lets you build a range of new and exciting things to your content. And as you progress through the game, so does the Syspocalpster, growing to become a thriving city full of life. That's an interesting idea. I'll kind of want to see how it's implemented. Let's see. There's actually quite a bit of new content in the LEGO Movie 2 video game, which is a breath of fresh air, especially to players who might have started getting slightly bored with the unusual formula. You can check out some of the new content in the latest preview below, which is a video, so I want to watch this video as a fan of LEGO games. Now, one of the things that I was
interesting,
not super happy with in the LEGO Video Game 1 was the fact that almost all of the cutscenes were directly copy and pasted cutscenes from the movie. And so you were just jumping into what were effectively very poorly rendering compressed videos. And not the entirety of the movie. At no point could you watch all of the movie, but also you really weren't seeing any content that was new. And I guess maybe that was a case in part of TT Games didn't have faith in the LEGO Movie 1 when they would have had to been developing it before the movie had come out and succeeded. Otherwise, there's really no reason why that should have happened like that. The LEGO Movie LEGO video game like a movie video game, one should have been one of the best TT games, and it kind of isn't. It's very forgettable. Also, by the time I played that game, I'd already played like dozens and dozens of other LEGO games that ran poorly on my PC. I also just found out that if I am going to buy a new video card, and there's almost a slight argument to buying an AMD video card, since AMD video cards are both in the PlayStation 4 and the Xbox One, and the Switch has a Tegra video card. There's almost an argument to that there might be better compatibility for PC games at some point in the future for AMD. That has not been the case at any point in history that I can recall. It still would be very iffy to do something like that. But there's a slightly bigger reason why something like that would be a potential thing to consider, because OBS just tweeted out that, hey, if you're having trouble recording or streaming while you're playing Apex Legends, try some of these things. And then it says the things that you should do. And then in a reply, they said, well, what if we just had a second video card dedicated to streaming so we can keep the graphics high at the maximum? And they said, no, that specifically won't work, because then that introduces a bunch of other problems. Guess we can do this. Deal 2 damage and then kill that. Hit this. Wing Fury. And this. Plus 3 attack. Hit that. We're good. Take that. And take that. And hit that. So yeah, I'm watching this video. It's like 12 minutes long. And yeah, it is a currency. I don't know if it's just red, blue, and green bricks that you did. They're the different currencies, or if it breaks down into multiple colors. Actually, looking now, it seems like, yes, there are quite a few different colors options. So it might be like 10 different primary colors. Because I'm seeing a white and a pink as a color too. Alright, you wanna play that way? You wanna play that way? Demon? Have a little pump up demon.
Job's done.
I would also say that you almost certainly would want to watch the LEGO Movie 2 before you played the video game. Otherwise you're going to spoil yourself on the movie. And then that's going to put you in a kind of weird position, because I'm not 100% sure that the game is going to be as good as the movie is. It probably isn't. But, you know, nothing here looks bad. There's a mini map for a LEGO movie, for a LEGO game. That's a little interesting. There's like 3 different currency health bars in the top left, when usually it would just be hearts and the number of studs you'd collected. It seems to me like there isn't a accounting for studs collected, just general studs, that's happening in the middle. Yeah. So I'm also seeing things getting broken that aren't dropping studs like crazy. So yes, you still will pick up studs. That's the second meter in the bar in the top left. But Now you're also collecting other kinds of studs. And these schematics look cool. They feel like what they've probably done is taken all of the stuff that was in LEGO Worlds and taken the things they liked and put it in this game. And you have a gun that will just build the things that you have schematics for. Like, I'm seeing an example here of somebody building a building, and then as soon as they build the building, they can purchase things from that building. Do I have to? But unlike LEGO Worlds, I'm pretty sure what you're building in this Sispockleberg, whatever it's called, is unique to your game. I think it's not connecting to other people. Looks like the menu has 6 or 7 different worlds you can transport yourself to. Maybe these are open world sandbox sections, or maybe these are levels. It's kind of hard to tell if you're in a level or not. In this, like, I may not actually be seeing any content that took place in an actual level.
Unleash me.
Let's see. This guy keeps stalling. Looking at this video too, it just kind of saddens me and reminds me that, yeah, LEGO Dimensions is done. Here's a cool thing. A Duplo monster just attacked the player character, and they knocked it on its back and had to ground pound it in its stomach while lying on its back. Yeah, I don't see anything bad here. Another good LEGO game at best. I mean, alright, how are we gonna do this? We don't need to silence anybody. We do this. Do this. And then do this. If I can just get 2 more damage on him, then I can win with this. But if he keeps taking out all my characters, I wonder if he's trying to play some kind of mechathon over here. Man, boy do I not have time to watch a 12-minute trailer preview of a LEGO game, though. Yeah, I skipped forward. Yeah. It looks pretty good. So, I'm a little bit hyped about that. Not a lot, though. I don't know if I'm really gonna spend any more energy playing any more LEGO games. I probably will, but I really would like to buy a new video card, and it's really hard to justify saving up all that money. That's the difference between what a Patreon donation could be used for and what a Steam wishlist donation could be used for. If somebody gifts me a gift card on Steam, I can only spend it on games, which is fine. There's still a good decent amount of games I want to buy, but I can't really buy a new video card from that. It's kind of a shame. Welcome. Man, if I just keep getting the win streak bonus, though. Still haven't played that many spells. CD Projekt Red is looking for an illustrator for Gwent. So, there's some people out there, the old school fantasy illustrators, drawlers that could probably do that job. It's in Warsaw, Poland, though, so... So, yeah, I don't know how many people are willing to relocate to Poland, or are in Poland by default. Let's see, we don't need those. Let's see. Game of Citra has an article. Marvel Strike Force developer Fox Next Games opens up an indie dev fund. There's nothing else to really say there other than... let's see. With an unspecified sum at its disposal, Fox Next Games Indie Fund has already picked up a few projects, including Altered Matters, Etherborn, and some yet unannounced titles.
Almost out of time.
All right. Let's play this, and this, and this, and then in the turn. Let's see, Game of Sutra has another article. American Sign Language emotes have been added to Star Citizen. That sounds like a great way to accidentally say something offensive to people. But it also seems like an interesting idea for people who might be hard of hearing, I guess. But there's definitely some weirdness there. Because what you're doing in that instance is having people sign with sign language in a situation where you're 100% guaranteed better off just subtitling it, or what is it? Closed captioning it. I think closed captioning is actually the one for people who are completely deaf. I saw somebody explain the difference once and then I forgot immediately what they said. So it would be so much easier in Star Citizen to have closed captions and subtitles and have both those options than it is to animate people to do sign language in emotes. It's really, really silly, an idea. If you were gonna integrate it into your storyline and you were gonna have a deaf character, okay. And then you had already animated people capable of signing that makes sense. Star Citizen is a space flying around a game, so maybe you're gonna run into aliens and sign language is how that you communicate with the language. There's a quote here, I'm really happy for the community to have this opportunity to be able to roleplay and express themselves in a way that they see fit. It's almost as if, and I don't know if this is true, but that seems really odd. It's almost as if deaf people are saying that we are happy that we have sign language and have to use sign language, and it's a part of our identity identifies us, which is not in general what I've heard for people who need to use sign language. They find it embarrassing that they have to live with it and that they're usually good natured about it, but like if given the chance to get hearing aids or something else and just live life as most people live their lives without having to go through sign language, they would almost certainly choose that immediately.
Your soul shall be mine.
It's like if somebody was missing a leg and they were saying they're happy that they have a prosthetic leg and that's become a part of their identity and that they would always choose to have that prosthetic leg over, say, some miracle pill that would grow back or grow a replacement appendage. Yeah. It probably, in a small way, and this is just general speculation, is some weird, like, SJW disability acceptance way of thinking. Where they want to put everything that is not normal and say, oh, it is normal, everything's normal. It's like, no, it's not normal to be deaf. It's not normal to be missing a leg. And anybody that really is deaf or missing a leg will tell you that. Moving on, because certainly don't have time to get into any kind of rants. Gamasutra has a blog, I think, here. How devs designed the Lego games to appeal to all ages. There's a paragraph here appealing to fans with in-jokes. The golden rule. The game's art direction is a key factor. Introducing new challenges or distractions. They're really good about that. For the most part, focus testing and play testing. The main thing that is wrong with Lego games is they just don't run on PC well. So while they may appeal to all ages, they certainly don't appeal to people who are playing on PC. Alright, do we want to kill this guy?
As you command.
Gamasutra has another article. Former Wargaming execs establish a new studio called Ganymede Games? G-A-N-Y-M-E-D-E? I don't know. I feel like I've heard of Ganymede. It's like a... sounds like a Doctor Who world. But... doesn't immediately sound familiar or come to mind what it would be from. Let's see. Let's see how. So, yeah. Former Wargaming execs Lynn Stetson and Jerry Prochazka has formed a new game studio with the help of veterans from Riot Games, id Software, and Blizzard Entertainment. Well, I could see why people would be leaving Blizzard. I could probably see reason why, if I think about it, why people are leaving Riot. And as far as id, isn't that's Bethesda. Yeah. But also, that could be three different people or fewer. That's always the problem when they phrase it that way. Is that you never really get a true count. Not yet. Let's hold on to that till the last. Let's see. Kristen, Ganymede Games. The new opening is based in Las Cruces, New Mexico. Interesting to be in New Mexico. I think Las Cruces might be close to the border to California. If I'm thinking right about geography at all. And it will, it will use the state's refundable film production tax credit to reclaim about 25% of its production expenses. So this is kind of a tax reason why they're in that area. Okay. Let's pump this up. And keep playing. In the turn. Let's see. As reported by Variety, the tax will help facilitate the creation of major movies like No Country for Old Men and The Avengers. So The Avengers and No Country for Old Men also use that tax credit, but this is the first time the game studio will reap the benefits. They're also hoping to tap the local talent pool and will build out Ganymede's infrastructure and headquarters with an investment worth over $1.3 million. If they're really just starting a business in a specific place because they are looking for a tax credit, that means they really don't have any interest in Your magic shall not save in staying there for the long haul. This is the kind of business that from day one you can make some pretty nasty assumptions that they would be more than willing to fire everybody at that office and shift all of their assets to a shell corporation and move any further work to, say, to Mexico or China or Korea or India or something. Like, if your number one thought is a tax credit, even if it is a really good 25% tax credit, that there's no loyalty there. It just never will happen. Right. So if I do this, I discard this. If I do this, I discard something else. So which is more important to play? That is, I suppose. Your soul is mine. There we go. Speaking about what sort of games they hope to create, the duo said they want to build short experiences that offer something new but still pack a punch. Quote, it's a good time to create new experiences because players are asking for that. Quote, we want to make games that are easy to get into and easy to get out of. We have busy lives, so we want short gaming experiences while still having lots of fun. That sounds like mobile games to me. So he healed himself back up to 30. Gamma Sutra has another article. 3DS sales have slowed, but Nintendo still sees a market for its long-running handheld. Not really. I mean, if the rumors are true about a smaller Nintendo Switch coming out relatively soon, that's gonna be the nail in the coffin for 3DS. And yeah. That totally makes sense too. It's like, what does the 3DS have to offer compared to a smaller, more mobile version of the Switch? All it has is the dual screens, which were always a nightmare and silly to program for and barely used. The 3DS has a thumb pad instead of the D-pad that's barely adopted. And that's kind of it. 3DS is cheaper. So with a smaller, more portable, and cheaper Switch coming out, that's the end of that. Of course, Nintendo's not going to say that until they've sold every single 3DS they have sitting in their storehouse. So, of course, they're going to say that they still see a future in it. Also, there's plenty of other third-party developers who are still probably working on a few games for the 3DS, although not too many. Like, unlike the Vita, I doubt we'll have a very long period of time in which third-party developers are still making games for the 3DS. And that'll just have to do with the adoption rate and the longevity of the 3DS in Japan compared to the Vita. Is there anything else in this article worth mentioning? Yeah, they throw out some numbers. It's a little inside baseball as far as how many have been sold. The final paragraph here says, this comes after Nintendo slightly lowered the full year Switch sales expectations from 20 million to 17 million. While the systems have been selling well, Nintendo leadership believes a failure of properly conveying the appeal of the Switch has lowered the forecast, and we have some other stories I think we'll run into where we hear that statement again. Moving on to the next story for now, Gamasutra has an article, Apex Legends crossed 1 million concurrent players in under 72 hours. Apparently, Microsoft made like a racing game called Apex for the 360, and that in part probably forced Apex Legends to be called Apex Legends, although it's a real bad name, and it is probably a statement that Titanfall is not getting a Titanfall 3, because you could have called this Titanfall Legends easily. Like, it would have been so, so easy to do that. And yet that didn't happen. Alright, what do we want to do first? Just make sure there's no booby trap there. Go. The thing about Apex Legends though is that it was never a game for me. I don't play battle royale multiplayer games, so I'm out of my league to really say too much about it. But I wouldn't be surprised from just my outside perspective if this is a bit of a flash in the pan, and as soon as the next big game comes out, people forget about it. It also feels like Apex Legends was put out specifically to help EA's bottom line, and it has succeeded at doing that. We have another article talking about that later. Because EA was losing money because of their quarterly report. It would be suspicious, though, to think that they were sitting on a good game for an extremely long amount of time just in case. So this probably is a pretty good example of very helpful timing on the part of scheduling your release. It would certainly explain why there was no real evident announcements or promotion for Apex Legends. As if they were trying to rush it out as fast as possible. Next, we have an article from TechRaptor. Here are the winners of the Steam Awards 2018. I saw this also on the Steam blog. I haven't looked at it yet, though. I don't even remember who I nominated. I thought for a second of maybe doing a video around it, but I don't really care enough, and I don't think there's a real reason to do it. Let's see. I mean, there might be a thought there, but I don't know. I don't know if any of these games that are winners are going to, by the way, get any kind of discount or be promoted in any way. I mean, certainly they'll get their award a year later, probably, but that's it. So, Game of the Year, the winner was PlayerUnknown Battlegrounds, okay. And then the other nominees were Monster Hunter World, Kingdom Come Deliverance, Hitman 2, and Assassin's Creed Odyssey. I'm fairly certain that all of the games that made it to the nomination level were pretty obvious games that were going to make it to the nomination level. And when I got from the point of being able to nominate to voting, I just voted on things that I thought would win or should win, in some kind of silly thought that perhaps maybe if you voted for a winner, you might get a discount or something for these games. Or, I don't know, some kind of badge or something. VR Game of the Year, the winner is The Elder Scrolls V Skyrim VR. Other options were VR Chat, Beat Saber, Fallout 4 VR, and Super Hot VR. Let's see. Let's go ahead and silence this.
Your magic shall not save
me. Hit this. And take the health, I guess. And then hit that. We have a labor of love. A labor of love category. The winner is GTA 5. Fall with other nominees being No Man's Sky, Path of Exile, Dota 2, or Stardew Valley. And then there is the best developers field, with CD Projekt Red being claimed as the best one, which, I mean, all that seems really, really silly to say who's the best developer. That's something that could only really be properly voted on by somebody who would work for those developers, and that would be almost impossible because you'd have to work for almost all of them, or at least work for one of them. But they gave CD Projekt Red. The other options were Ubisoft, haha, Bethesda, not really, Rockstar Games, not really, Digital Extremes, Square Enix, haha, Capcom, probably not, Paradox Interactive, Bandai Namco, probably not, and Clay. That was a very stupidly thought of category to start with. Let's see. They had a category for best environment. Witcher 3 got it. Other options were, other nominees were Subnautica, Shadow of the Tomb Raider, Far Cry 5, and Dark Souls 3. For the category of better with friends, Rainbow Six Siege got it, with other nominees being Payday 2, Dead by Daylight, Counter-Strike Global Offensive, and Overcooked 2. This guy is getting more health somehow. Next category is best alternate history. Assassin's Creed Odyssey won it, with other nominees being Wolfenstein 2, Hearts of Iron 4, Civilization 6, and Fallout 4. And then the next category is most fun with the machine, where Rocket League won, with other nominees being Euro Truck Simulator 2, Nier Automata, Factorio, and Space Engineers. And let's just scroll back here again, and look at every single nominee. You have Nier Automata, Dark Souls 3. There are some developers that are Japanese developers that didn't win. And yeah, that's it. Monster Hunter World, yeah, that also for Game of the Year. So, still a pretty considerably lacking amount of Japanese games listed there. Maybe that was fair. I would really have to go through a list of every game that came out in 2018 to see if when you take out Monster Hunter and Nier Automata, maybe there really weren't any good Japanese games that came out last year, but I think that's probably not true. I think Dragon Quest came out last year, and there's definitely more games that should have been considered if these categories were a little bit better developed. All these categories are kind of dumb. Like, it should just be some basic, what's the best action game, what's the best adventure game, what's the best fighting game, what's the best visual novel, so that there's a level of fairness there. But then again, I guess all of this is in English, and maybe a lot of Japanese people don't even play on Steam, so that might be a factor too. See, we gotta play a lot of spells, so let's switch over to Spell Hunter. Also, we're kind of losing at rank 18. But this also is a sampling of people who play on Steam, unless they broke up. I mean, this is worldwide, as far as I can tell. So begin. Maybe that's right. My criticism is in the categories as to who won. That was a popular vote, although the categories skewed who was going to win anyways, and some of these categories make no sense at all. Some of these some of the things that made it to the nominations also probably didn't deserve to be there. And the nominations, I do not believe, were a popular vote. Or at least they weren't completely a popular vote. So for the five games that were able to be in the running for Game of the Year, that might have been Steam in the background, the Valve in the background going, we're going to only let PUBG, Monster Hunter World, Kingdom Come Deliverance, Hitman 2, and Assassin's Creed Odyssey win there. Not that there would really be a big difference if it was a popular vote or if it wasn't, because most people still wouldn't find some obscure indie title and try to make it Game of the Year, even if there was a huge meme going on during the time, it still wouldn't be enough votes to skew the results.
What fools these mortals be!
Now, so far we haven't looked at any games on Steam, but there actually are quite a few. So we're gonna change that right now. So we have a game on Steam called Void Ship: The Long Journey. Looks like it's a flying around, shooting things asteroid clone with RPG elements and a little bit better animation than what we normally see. This looks more like a 4X game than just a fly around asteroids game, so yeah. It's $11.19 discounted. I want to see some things here. I want to see if I can find a game with Metacritic on it or OpenCritic review, but I guess none of the new games would have that, so I'll have to look at something that's been out for a while. I want to see something that has loot boxes that has an OpenCritic review and see if that works with my plugin to highlight that as something that I wouldn't want to deal with. Okay, tracking. I'll take this. I did that wrong. Well, that cost me one damage. Let me look at this game first. Because it's tagged with sexual content. I have no idea what this is, but it looks fun to mention. So we've got this game on Steam called Self-Reliance, and then a bunch of Asian characters. It looks like it might be a Chinese full motion video. Best I can guess is that this is gonna have something to do with you becoming pregnant and a single mother from all of the symbols. It's free and it's English and simple Chinese. It is a sex education game. The player will grow up the game's characters together, where they will have a choice and the player's decision can shift the game. Yeah, the last thing I would want to do is trust a sex education to a cheap Chinese game or a Chinese endorsed game at all. That sounds like that is just destined to be rife with misinformation or poor information. Let's see. Yeah, you don't get a country with as many people as China has with it, well, also having good sex education going on. That may be a little bit more of a joke than a serious statement, but yeah, you just don't get that level of overpopulation just by accident. So yeah, that's not making it to the follow list. Gemasutra has an article, ex-Telltale developers form Ad Hoc Studio and set sights on narrative-focused games. So Ad Hoc Studios is probably going to just be Telltale version 2.0. For developers that departed Telltale Games in the years leading up to the company's turbulent end of rejoining forces, this time to freshly founded indie game developer Ad Hoc Studio. This will be an interesting experiment because this will, because there were stories that it was the newest last boss of Telltale that basically drove it into the ground. And there were stories that it was the second to last boss of Telltale that drove it into the ground. So if either one of those are true, these four developers, who I assume do not include either one of those bosses, will succeed just fine. If that is not the full truth, then this will fail. And it honestly has a good chance to fail anyways, because Telltale games were kind of played out after the Walking Dead series. Like, they could have, really should have limited themselves down to, we're going to do the Walking Dead series in this format, and then we're going to do something completely different. Just do an old school point and click adventure game for some of the other games we make. Like, I can see The Walking Dead and The Wolf Among Us using that format, survive. But trying something different when they had licenses for Game of Thrones, for instance. Yeah, the Game of Thrones game in particular should have been a much bigger success than it was. Let's go ahead and play this. The team is made up, the four people that are making up Ad Hoc Studio are Michael Chong, Nick Herman, Dennis Lenart, and Perry Shoret. And it aims to use the small studio size to explore adventurous and risky ideas that they say would typically be difficult to pitch and develop with a larger team. Well, from the perspective of Telltale, there was nothing getting pitched and developed there at that game. Like, after The Walking Dead happened, and even before The Walking Dead, like, after they had the license for Jurassic Park and Back to the Future, there was no new intellectual property game that came out. It was all licensed games, which was a terrible business plan, because it means that they would never have owned anything, and they never did own anything.
Job's done.
So, yeah. What very possibly will happen in the future is all the licenses will expire for Telltale games, even if they are still available to be purchased, and they'll just not be available right. Even if they're still available to be purchased right now, the licenses might expire in a year, 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, 10 years, and nobody's going to spend the time to renegotiate that. This is a dangerous way to start a business, too, because you have four people in charge already, which means that this will inevitably split up into fewer people. It's just going to happen. Like, one person needs to be in charge to make a decision. At the very worst case scenario, it should be three or five people. That way there's at least somebody that can always break a tie. You're gonna, if this truly is gonna become this democratic company, people are gonna deadlock all the time. Let's see. Let's see, there's a quote here. We like the idea that it was just the four of us. We'd be able to more confidently wade into unfamiliar water.
Look how it burns!
Yeah, that's kind of it. So far, the studio hasn't announced any projects or partnerships, but conversations from the full interview outline how the team wants to create an interactive experiences, potentially even full motion video games that appeal to a similar audience as Bandersnatch, Netflix game. Quote, making interactive experiences with real actors on the screen is something we've always talked about. We all have backgrounds and interest in film and television, so combining that with our experience in games is something we're exploring right now. Yeah, it kind of feels like Ad Hoc Studios is almost certainly doomed to failure from day one. It's just kind of an idea. We didn't have anything better to do. We wanted to make our resume say we were still employed somewhere, so we're gonna do that. And I guess this is better than all four of them forming individual indie companies. And four people with a lot of experience could easily expand to a 100-person team pretty easily. They have the connections, and in the video game world, having connections and cronyism is the name of the game, so... They know who to call to hire if they need something done. Right. Nope. Two and one.
This
is still bad. That's the worst thing I could have done, but whatever. GameIndustry.biz, this is kind of a follow-up story to a story we said earlier. EA stocks bounce back in the wake of Apex Legends' success. After an 18% drop following quarter three financials, the company is now trading higher before the dip. So, honestly, if you had shorted the stock of EA, if you had some general idea or insider knowledge, which would be insider trading and illegal, but if you had some general idea that EA's stocks quarter three financials were going to be low, and you just picked a number at random and said, I want to short EA stock right now, the day before they release their information, by 10%, just at random, you would, make probably quite a lot of money. Because then you could buy back. Shorting stock is you're taking a incredibly short-term loan. It should be illegal, quite frankly. But you're taking this short-term loan to bet that the stock will go down lower in price. And so you're taking a loan to sell all the stock you have right now and buy the same amount of stock shares at a lower price within a very short amount of time. So if the stock shares were selling for, say, $100 a share and it went down 10%, then they would be selling for $90 a share. You buy them back for $90 a share. You've made $10 profit for every share you did that on. But of course, you would have to be rich and have shares in EA in the first place, which, as a long-term investment goal, investing in a video game company is a terrible idea. And let's face it, quarter four sales for EA probably won't be any better, because Apex Legends is free to play, and even if it does bring in some microtransactions money, I wouldn't be surprised if there's a still significant loss, unless EA has something else under that sold well. Let's see. We have Martin on the chat. Hi, do you know the game Heroes 3? If you mean Heroes of Might and Magic 3, yes, I played it a lot when it first came out, and it is really, really slow. It's a pretty great game, or it was when it came out, at least. But certainly not something I would spend too much time covering. If I had it on Steam, I'm not even sure it's available on Steam. I may already own it, but it's really is one of those games where even if I was to play the tutorial mode and show it off, it would be so slow. If there's another game called Heroes 3, though, I have no idea. Like, there probably are two or three other games called Heroes that you could be talking about. Yeah. Right.
I hunt alone.
Oh man, why am I doing that?
Well played.
I don't know. Let's see. Is this something that you need to talk about? No, this article is just talking about a Kickstarter game, and I don't believe in hyping up my fans on Kickstarter games and getting hyped on games that very possibly will never get made. Alright, so next story then is a Gamma Sutra story. Let's see. What do we want to do here? 5. That sucks.
I hunt alone.
Let's see. Martin says, "Oh yes, I love Dungeon."
Behold the tools.
Yeah,
of creation.
I talked for this. Okay, I didn't quite understand that. But I think that was a yes. He is talking about Heroes of Might and Magic 3. And maybe he's referencing Dungeons & Dragons. There's never really been a video game Dungeons & Dragons games that has been hugely successful. So that my understanding and knowledge of it ends at that statement. I know Dungeons & Dragons is somewhat popular, is very popular amongst people who play Dungeons and Dragons, but that's pretty much it. I did play Heroes Quest, which I think is very similar to Dungeons and Dragons once, and again, same issue, takes way too much time. It was fun, but it took a lot of setup and a lot of time. People that play video games, or at least I found for myself, and I think this probably applies to a lot of video game players, is we don't want those extremely long experiences with that are kind of low in interactions and high in imagination. Not to say it cruelly, we want, if you play video games, you want high amounts of audio and visual stimulation and interactivity. Something that you don't get in any other format, really. Whereas Dungeons and Dragons is, you'll get somebody telling you a story in Dungeons and Dragons, and then you have to use your imagination. And visually, you're just looking at little plastic pieces and numbers and statistics. It's more of a left brain versus right brain style of gameplay. There's just a big difference, I think, in most gamers and people who play Dungeons and Dragons a lot. Not that there isn't overlap, I just don't think there's a lot of overlap. Which is always weird, because then you see these geek YouTube channels and TV shows and stuff that try to pander to both crowds, and it's like, it's unbelievable to me that somebody is also into video games and spending all their times playing video games, but they're also into Dungeons and Dragons, but they're also into comic books, but they're also into anime, but they're also into reading manga. It's like, no, you can't have but one master, really. You have your main hobby, and maybe if you're really diverse, you'll have a side hobby, but one is gonna be your favorite. Martin says, Dungeon is the town there. Dungeon town. Yeah. You're talking about which of the mini castles and heroes of Magic 3. Yeah, it's been over a decade since I played Heroes of Might and Magic 3. It's kind of a shame that they didn't make any newer ones recently, and the ones after 3 were kind of not as well received. So, like, there was a 4, there was a 5, they went into some weird episodic releases, I think, in either 5 or 6, so there was like 5 different versions of Heroes of Might and Magic 6, and then it kind of just stopped at that. Moving on, though, Gamma Switch has an article. Switch missed hardware target because Nintendo didn't, quote, convey appeal of the system. Nintendo believes the inability to sell consumers on the appeal of the Switch hardware and software prevented the console from meeting sales expectations. They expected 20 million units by the end of fiscal year March 31st, 2019, but they recently lowered the forecast to 17 million units. The economy hasn't been too great either, so I could see people, at least in the United States, not spending money on their kids. But also, it's really, really believable that people would not be willing to spend the $350+ for the Switch on their kids regardless. It's just too high of a price point. You can sell teenagers on that and college kids and people in their 20s on spending that much for like an Xbox and a PlayStation. Just gonna play that. Draw 5 different secrets from your deck. Do I wanna play protectively or aggressively? Let's just play aggressively. Although the company still did manage to grow year over year in hardware sales, the article continues. There's a quote here. Additionally, while we expected the releasing titles during the holiday system would increase sales, the year-on-year sales increase during the first half of the fiscal year, April to September, turned out to not be big enough. So it's almost an admission that the games that came out were not system sellers, which sounds pretty believable. Another explosive trap. And go. Moving into the next fiscal year, Furukawa, the president of Nintendo, I believe, wants to see Nintendo increased both Switch hardware and software sales by, quote, enriching its game roster and better marketing of the device. Nintendo not happy with its not meeting its goals, but Nintendo has like 100 years of cash to sit on, so they can have a bad year. No problem there for them. And I believe this is Furukawa's kind of first year on the job, as I believe he is the first not Nintendo Dynasty president, let me phrase that better. Up until this point, everybody who was president of Nintendo was related to the original founder of Nintendo of Japan, and he isn't. Although some of that might be kind of fishy too, because there's some weirdness on how things are done in Japan like that, where grown men will adopt other grown men as their sons just so they can say it's still a family business. Like a 70-year-old will adopt a 50-year-old and say, "You're my son now." Did we play enough spell cards? Well, I think 18, rank 18 is good enough for now. We still have plenty of days to try and push that up higher. And that took a little bit longer than I thought it was going to. So let's move over to the, oh man, battle.net. Net's gonna have to reload. So yeah. Let's move on to the European account now. Meanwhile, TechRaptor has an article, Ace Combat 7 Skies Unknown review. I want to skip down here and see what they say. Ace Combat 7 is getting more reviews than I think it would have in previous years. Like, this legitimately is the first time I've ever even heard of Ace Combat, so there's been six games before that point, and nothing has been mentioned. TechRaptor gave it an 8.5 grade. The summary is Ace Combat 7 Skies Unknown has a few annoying elements, but that doesn't take away from the fact that it's exactly what the series needed for a great combat comeback. Pros are phenomenal gameplay, fantastic weather system, great boss fights, wonderful soundtracks, and a good use of PlayStation VR. Cons are an iffy story, kind of anime story, terrible checkpoints, a few boring missions, and forgettable multiplayer, but it's still got an 8.5, which is a very high score. Speaking of high scores, I guess it's still worth it to roll this. Yeah. So, spells and turns. And over on this is already done. So, we're just gonna play ranked. And I guess we'll stay with Tempo Mage here and try to get up in ranked. Yeah, Ace Combat 7 I believe is on Steam, so I could think about playing it. It would be an interesting start to maybe learning to love flying simulator games, dogfighting flying simulator games in particular. I have a couple old ones that I've played, but nothing that's actually been interesting or good. In fact, speaking of a flying simulator racing game, in this case we have Infinite Skyline that came out on Steam, which says it's a simulation racing game. This looks a little bit cut and pasty on the buildings, but it does kind of look like a layout of, I believe this is New York, if I was to guess, or a randomly generated area. I don't think I'd like this though, as I'm watching the video and watching people fly all around upside down and such. There's some weirdness with the plane being a third person perspective, and it kind of staying stationary in the middle of the screen and the rest of the world moving, particularly when you get the camera goes upside down. Yeah, this is not, I think, something I would want to spend effort on. Infinite Skyline is discounted for $5.94. And yeah, that would be a bad entry, I think. If I'm going to play a flying around game, Ace Combat's at the top of the list. Infinite Skyline is at the middle of the list. It'd be like, this is mediocre at best. Alright. Well, let's end the turn there. Gamma Sutra has an article, "Get a Job, Wizards of the Coast is looking for a senior software engineer," which that implies that Wizards of the Coast needs a software engineer to help Magic the Gathering Arena become a better game, or help their next game that they're developing to replace Magic the Gathering Arena be a better game. Wizards of the Coast is now owned by Hasbro, I believe. Yeah, it even says that in the description. So I can't imagine that they have much of anything else that they're developing the game for. Although I think Wizards of the Coast also does do the Pokemon trading card game. They probably wouldn't do a video game version of that. Game Freak would. If you want this job, it is in Renton, Washington. I'm not sure I particularly want to work for Wizards of the Coast, though. They don't strike me as probably the smartest group of people. And I'm just... Science overwhelmed. Just trying to do everything possible to stay alive, yeah? Next, we have a game on Steam called Commersant. It says, this game will teach you how to think positively. This looks to me like this is probably just a low-effort kind of joke game, troll game. Yeah, the graphics are not visually very interesting, and... yeah. I don't see anything here that would sell me on it. It's early access for no reason. It's discounted to $4.24, which is an odd price. English, Russian languages. Yep. That sounds like a Russian troll game to me.
I wonder.
Starlight.
And do that.
Feeble mind.
Gamma Sutra has an article. The EA CEO claims poor marketing, delays, and Battle Royale woes put Battlefield 5, which is a better way to phrase it than what I had heard before this point, because in previous ones it was just blaming. I've seen articles saying, well, he was just blaming the fact that the single player was bad, or the fact that they had to put single player in it at all. He was blaming the single player somehow in Battlefield 5, which I imagine the single player isn't great in Battlefield 5, but I don't think it's probably the problem. They've been actively trying to excise single player in games like Battlefield for a while now, and that's certainly the point where I lose interest, but then I was never really a fan of the Call of Duty or Battlefield games in the first place, so I'm not the target audience. Right. I think we've got a victory next turn. Let's see. Is there anything in this article more to take from this? The World War II shooter sold 7.3 million units during quarter three, around 1 million less than they initially anticipated. That doesn't feel like that's a small number, though. Like, 7.3 million is a big number. They're just asking for too much. EA standards are too high, and that's the problem with all publicly owned companies, is that the demands for more and more profit never stop. Let's see, speaking during a recent earnings call, he also claimed the decision to prioritize a single player campaign over Battle Royale mode, which will eventually launch in March 2019, 4 months after Battlefield 4 first hit shelves also hurt sales. So this is almost a stupidly easy claim to prove or disprove. All we have to do is wait till March and see if the Battle Royale mode that comes out for Battlefield 5 makes them 100 million more sales. Or no, not 100 million, 1 million more sales. So from this point, from the release of Battlefield 5 to the end of quarter 3, take that same amount of time, and then give that same amount of time when the Battle Royale comes out, and see if a million sales happen. And the answer will almost certainly be no. And honestly, if Battlefield 5 did have Battle Royale, it might have helped a little, but I don't really know if it would. There's a quote here: if I think about Battlefield 5 more holistically, I think we did not do a great job of building momentum early in the project, he commented. Which is to say, I wouldn't have made all that bad press about it and put a cybernetic female commando on the front of the box. Yeah, for all his talk about that, he's not doubling down on any of that virtue signaling now that the game has failed to sell. Here's a quote: and I think it's not just about the context of development, but I think about this in the context of a broader execution against the entire campaign. Our launch didn't resonate as strongly as we would have liked it to with players, and we were never truly able to catch up. So he's just admitting that the promotion of the game, the way they chose to promote it, was not good. This is a example of the get woke go broke slogan meme.
We have many secrets.
He suggested the game stalled while competitors like Call of Duty and Red Dead Redemption 2 and Fortnite continued to gain momentum, leaving Battlefield fighting an uphill battle when it eventually landed on shelves. Quote, I think we made the right decision to move the title in service of quality of the game, and on balance, those who bought the game really enjoyed it, and the game was better for that move. And then there's another quote: but the combination of poor start in our marketing campaign together with what I think was a longer development cycle that put us into a more competitive window. So there's a bit there where he's blaming the people developing the game for not developing the game fast enough, which is probably an indication he's going to try and lay off the team that developed Battlefield 5. And what does that leave you for Battlefield 6? Probably will take a little bit longer to come out. Maybe it will be developed by a completely different team. Maybe it won't come out at all. I doubt it's going to try and rush out the door and turn out to be way better than Battlefield 5 it was. Moving on, Gamasutra has another article, an obituary notice. Renowned Atari ST programmer Steve Bock, B-A-K, has passed away. I guess we can do a web peek here so you can see Steve Bock there. Let's see. He worked on titles including Star Ray, Gold Runner, Spitting Image. Of course, he's an Atari programmer, so if you didn't play any Atari games, then you probably have no idea who he is, and that includes me. Like, I'm not a clue. Never heard of him. But he probably was very influential to the first generation of video game development. Like, Bach once, the article continues, Bach rose to prominence during the 80s after accomplishing breakthrough feats on the Atari ST, most notable which came when he proved smooth scrolling was possible on the console with the creation of the vertical shooter Gold Runner. He also teamed up with Chris Sorrell to create James Pond for Millennium, which went on to spawn a successful franchise, the James Pond franchise. I've heard of it. I'm not sure I've actually played any of them. Let's see, Bach had been living with diabetes in recent years, and his son Philip broke the news of his passing on Twitter. There's a quote here from his son. Let's see, nothing video game related on there, it's just a touching sentiment. Let's see.
I wonder
if there's anything more video game related in all of this. Nope. Nope. There's about three paragraphs here that would just be sad to read out loud. We're gonna continue to see first generation developers die. And we're probably not too close to starting to see more second generation video game programmers pass too.
I wonder.
I wanna do this. And this. And I want to do this. And I want to do that. Gamasutra has another article. Zynga's mobile games generates a record 228 million revenue last quarter. So Zynga, let's see, what does Zynga do? Is that... they make mobile games, but I'm trying to remember which ones. Like Worlds of Friends, Merge Dragons, Worlds of Candy, Wonka's World of Candy. So yeah. There are some top tier mobile game developers out there that make a lot of money. But then I think 99.9% of every other mobile developer doesn't make a dime, or they're barely making pennies on ads. Gamasutra has a blog here, an improved way of grabbing objects in VR with Unity 3D. This is a programming blog though, so it really wouldn't be too interesting to read unless you're into programming, so I'll just mention the title and move on. Let's see. Should have done that first. GameIndustry.biz has an article. Gaming business bolsters Bandai Namco's quarter three profits. This might be the only story we have of a company that actually made profits for quarter three. Yeah, I'm not sure anybody, any other big name developer made profits. And Bandai Namco does other things that make video games. Notably, they make anime at the very least, and they probably do a bunch of other things in Japan, running arcade things, or I wouldn't be surprised if that's what the, if they run arcades. Alright. Yeah, we gonna do this? We can take out this and that and that. And then end of turn and hope that's enough. May not be. That's 9 damage. He only needs to do 3 more damage to me. So the subtitle on this article is Soul Calibur publisher increases full year guidance following solid holiday sales in network entertainment segment. Let's see if there's anything else besides Soul Calibur that would have increased their money. The company saw a net sales of, will translate just to English, 1.77 billion up from 1.6 billion in the same quarter last year, and a gross profit of 648 million up from 556 million last year. Could have done more. Let's see. Specifically video games, the company saw 238 million during the quarter, putting it at 599 million for the last 9 months. That's still a bit behind the company's full year forecast of 874 million in home video game sales, though Bandai Namco is likely counting on the upcoming major releases like Ace Combat 7 or Jump Force to push it the rest of the way of its projections. Alright. How are we gonna do this? We've lost. Let's just do this, do this. And do that for good measure. Broken down, Bandai Namco released 68 new titles globally in the past 9 months, not including localized versions, and sold nearly 18 million total units. So Bandai Namco must have released a lot of anime-esque games that nobody really thinks about, and mobile games, I wouldn't be surprised too. Since the start of the year, Bandai Namco has increased its guidance for the full year, now projecting net sales of 6.5 billion and gross profits of 2.3 billion. And network entertainment sales of 3 billion. See, there's probably something rather prophetic and important to take away from the fact that I don't think many people, including myself, would ever say of all the AAA developers that release games, who would actually make money, because everybody else is not going to make money. I would never guess Bandai Namco. So there's always this underlying fan base, particularly of anime. I mean, it's a niche fan base, but it's there. There's an underlying fan base of games out there, certain kinds of games that don't get a lot of promotion, don't get talked about a lot, but they sell, and yet they make money. Meanwhile, the game you would expect to make money, Battlefield 5, didn't make money. Maybe that's because, well, it did make money, but it didn't meet expectations, so maybe that's because expectations are too high, and Bandai Namco just doesn't set its expectations that high, and they just have a better chief financial officer. Or maybe it's because not as many people as you think still are those college Xbox gamer bros that never existed until Microsoft basically invented them with Halo, and then they have now either matured or stopped playing games because they have kids of their own. And so those annual first-person shooters that are nothing but multiplayer experiences don't seem like they really succeed anymore. That might even hurt games like Borderlands 3, which I like Borderlands, certainly. But I wouldn't be surprised if maybe it doesn't have as much sales as you would think when it comes out, because there'll just be less people wanting to play it in multiplayer mode. Let's see. I don't know if there's a real story here to say, but yeah, we'll talk about it later. But Steam has this video streaming ability where you can buy videos on Steam. Most of the videos were video game related videos anyways, but it seems like they're kind of starting to shut that down and shutter it. That they put out some guidance that Valve has that seems to imply that they're going to take any videos down that aren't directly video game related, which is going to disenfranchise a few small indie people who put their videos on Steam to sell for that 30% cut, compared to putting it somewhere else. Like, there's probably a large collection of other places you could put it on, put your videos and get better sales. Like, put it on YouTube, put it on iTunes, put it on Pornhub even. Would probably be a better move than putting videos on Steam. I would never consider to have a digital video library on Steam. The selection is just not there. And frankly, it confuses the issue quite a bit when you're trying to search for certain things, because you'll often get these video results if you're searching something more obscure instead of video game results, because they both are in the same search box. So well, I may talk about that more if there's anything more to say. We've got this game on Steam called Operation Babel New Tokyo Legacy, and then a bunch of Asian characters. It looks like it's mixed. It's from NIS America as the publisher. It looks like it is probably, it says it's a JRPG dungeon crawler, so these are probably cutscenes that were being shown right now. And yeah, the actual game makes it look like a dungeon crawler visual novel style game. It's $14.99 discounted, and English and Japanese. Yep. I don't think that there's anything here that would be particularly interesting. This very possibly is also just a mobile game being ported. I could see a lot of dungeon crawlers in particular getting moved to mobile, even if they are not originally from mobile, just in an effort to
we have many secrets.
Make more sales and not have to compete with higher quality products, because most dungeon crawler games are low quality products and the developers know it. I don't see anything here that would convince me to want to play this. I'm not sure I'd ever want to play a dungeon crawler, quite frankly. Alright, we got a decent amount of spells. So, let's hit this. Hit this. And hit this. And then end of turn. Next, we have a game on Steam called VR Sand, which looks like it's just a VR demo of playing with sand physics. It looks very voxel-y and pixel-y. Nothing here looks interesting. Playing any kind of VR game with just like a black background skybox is going to be very annoying quickly. This is $4.99 with no discount. Yeah. Yeah, it almost feels like you're trying to paint in 3D. Honestly, if you're gonna make anything in 3D, I don't think VR is the right move at all for that. Like, look at that, we got a victory. Like, if you're, I think 3D things still are gonna be made mostly on 2D screens by real animators, and then maybe you test your 3D objects in VR, but the vast majority of your time I think it's gonna be still 2D. I don't think it adds much. We've been making 3D models in software like Blender for years and years, if not a couple decades now. So you don't need a third dimension to make something 3D. In a similar story, I saw a video somebody promoting a software to turn kind of quickly convert 2D layered Photoshop images from comic books like Marvel and DC comic books into VR 3D experiences. Basically what it does is it takes each layer and does basically what the Virtual Boy did, making first parallax perspectives. So if you tilt your head to the left, the background layer will move to the left a lot, but the foreground layer will just barely move to the left, or maybe it will move the other direction. And so that makes it feel like there's something sort of like a distance there. It looked kind of interesting when using Marvel and DC images that have thick black outlines around their characters. But it probably would get really frustrating, and I don't think it would add anything to comic books anyway. I think as an outsider who's not really a comic book fan, the thing comic books, in particular DC and Marvel, need to do is have better stories and better animation and just more content in general happen. Before they throw in gimmicks like 3D. Comic books have almost always been selling themselves on gimmicks, and that has not helped grow their industry. TechRaptor has an article. Take-Two stocks falls despite huge Red Dead Redemption 2 sales. According to its quarter 3 sales report, Rockstar publisher Take-Two went above and beyond its sales expectations thanks mainly to Red Dead Redemption 2 sales being extremely high. So even when you meet the expectations, being a publicly traded company is just not healthy for your stock's price. Rockstar's latest sold 23 million copies to retail and was the best-selling game of 2018 despite launching in November. Amazingly, it also achieved a bigger opening weekend in retail regarding any and all entertainment releases, as Red Dead Redemption 2 sales were absolutely insane. So for its quarter ending December 31st, 2018, Take-Two reported $1.57 billion in net bookings, beating its expectations. It's expected 1.40 to 1.45 billion. The number is also up 140% year over year, although what was Rockstar selling last year? Probably nothing. So that's a slightly disingenuous comparison. Let's see. It also founded $1.248 billion in revenue with projections of $1.1 to $1.15 billion. So it made more in revenue. Overall, it profited $350 million. While Red Dead Redemption sales were a big push, the game's online feature drove it even further. this article continues. Also, titles like NBA 2K and Civ 6 for the Switch performed very well. However, despite increased profits, Take-Two stock went down 13.83% because investors expected even more. Man, if you're a video game owner, man, if you own any company, go private. Do not go public. Investors are cutthroat lunatics. They don't even know what they're asking for. Let's see. Do this. And do this. And do this. There we go. Is there anything else to say here? Investment predictions. Expected $680 million in profit. Apparently, they just wanted more money. Let's see. Just greedy investors. Just keep on playing. Here, the call to continue this article. The call also revealed an unannounced game will launch in the fiscal year 2020. This could be Borderlands 3, an unannounced Bioshock game, or a new IP. It's probably Borderlands 3, but if it is Borderlands 3, that means we're not seeing it in 2019, which I would be surprised. Otherwise, Ancestors, The Humanity Odyssey, and the other worlds are still coming this year, so that they don't... Those two games I haven't even heard of, Ancestors, The Humankind Odyssey, and The Other Worlds. Those are two different names, I assume. And the monthly user active count for GTA Online and Red Dead Online will make them some money. Let's see. There's also a quote here related to the Epic Store and exclusivity that was commented on during this earnings call. Someday I'll be just like you. And hit that. Quote, from our point of view, we don't see another retailer as disruptive. We want to be where the consumer is, and if there's competitive offering that benefits consumers, generally speaking, if the business model makes sense for us, we will support it. We see competition in the retail side to be a good thing. It just means more distribution. So, okay. But there's a big if there, if it benefits consumers. So far, Epic has really not put anything out that looks like, to me, it benefits consumers. Their offerings have been rather pathetic. And, like, honestly, in the past couple of weeks, they've had to tweet out service disruption notices. Which I follow Valve, I follow Steam support. I don't see anything on there. Maybe I don't follow Steam support anymore, actually. I don't see any announcement that Steam is down or this part of Steam is not working. So if those things do happen, which they probably do, they're not as frequent as what Epic is running into right now. Suppose it's worth mentioning that during an earnings call, the CEO is talking to people who own shares of the company, and it is possible that some of those shareholders have kids or play the games themselves, so they sometimes, on rare occasions, actually know what's going on, and will ask questions like, Would you go into the Epic exclusivity? And what is your plan there? Whereas I imagine a lot of the questions are very basic questions and not really helpful or informatively answered. I bet you get a lot of something akin to a Senate confirmation meeting in the United States where nothing is asked and nothing is said. We already talked about this, but Gamma Sutra has the same article. Marvel Strike Force developer Fox Next Games opens up an indie dev fund. There's really no real details there. And there we go, victory. I think this is probably a good point to take a little bit of a break. I'm just gonna take like a 5-minute break and end this recording. And I got the fuzzy graphics again. Oh man, how do you even fix that? All right. Well, we're going to end with the fuzzy graphics. Everything's rendering wrong. So that's going to be the end for this recording. And then if you're watching this live, this is going to take a break for just about 5 minutes. And then we'll come back and do another episode. As always, I ask you to like, share, subscribe, comment, and watch every second of my videos. If you want a friend to follow me on any social media sites, there's a whole bunch of links down below in the description box. And if you want to support me even further, there's a link to Patreon, or you can friend me on Steam and gift me a game off my wishlist. Thank you for watching. Have a good evening.